Hi everyone, I woke up this morning thinking about 25% of Google code has been replaced by AI. And it got me thinking about the structure of work and how AI is impacting our jobs. And in the last video, I talked about creating a career out of your hobbies. This video, I will discuss how AI is disrupting the workforce, but not only that, it's creating opportunities. And for that, I got on a phone with Anna Balduzzi, and she's actually the board member of SameGrain, which is an award-winning B2B, B2C, and B2G platform that utilizes machine learning algorithms. It's a patented technology, by the way. I had a conversation with her for 30 minutes and asked her a bunch of questions about AI and got to pick her brain. So if you stay for this video, you're gonna get some idea as to what's happening with AI and how it impacts the job market. What's really cool about my conversations with Anna is actually we had conversations before when she was working in Maryland, and I interviewed for a job position with a state-funded VC, and she actually was the woman that I interviewed with. I almost worked for her. She told me that 25% of the code at Google is replaced by AI, and I was wondering if that had anything to do with the layoffs, where like 15% of the workforce was laid off in the past year. She absolutely said that software engineers, a lot of them will be laid off, but they will also have opportunities such as managing. They will become the AI agents, meaning that software engineers would just check code instead of actually creating the code. So they are the AI agents, or the agents of AI, where they're checking code. So that's going to be like the new opportunity for engineers, that instead of creating all of this code, they will just check the algorithms and be able to manage them. I asked her, so what's the low-hanging fruit for AI? She did talk about chatbots. And if you know anything about Google Notebook LM training tool, where you can upload documents and turn into flashcards, podcasts, whatever, she really mentioned that that is a great low-hanging fruit, an AI tool where you can kind of get involved and learn certain processes and systems using AI. And that's a Google Notebook. I haven't tested it yet, so that's on my list too. What's cool about that tool is that if you're a podcaster or teacher or lawyer, you can actually convert your information into training material, then you can sell online. So it's almost like you become your own educator, and it just helps you better express the information and communicate. As a content creator and as a teacher, the challenge is always what systems to use to create the material and how to monetize it. So we didn't talk too much about monetization as a result of this Google Notebook tool, but we did talk about is how work will be structured differently. So with tools like that, how is it structured differently? So we have a lot of time that is created, meaning that the AI is able to do a lot of the menial tasks. But then we also have an opportunity to be creative and see how we can use these tools to better manage our time, which is super cool. And as I mentioned before, the AI agents are the software engineers who will basically manage AI. They actually have their time freed up because they no longer are writing code. AI is a tool that creates a different learning style, and this is where we headed. So where's the biggest opportunity is we have to ask, what industries will AI disrupt? Definitely, we talked about education and healthcare. With education, we have more access to tools and knowledge that we can then repackage and be able to directly go to consumers with the information. So that's important. And healthcare, that is a whole nother sector with lots of opportunities. For example, my friend's company, SynCare, he uses AI to equip surgeons during surgery. So a lot of hospitals, they're thinking of ways of using AI to assist in surgeries and all of their different systems in the hospital, which is very interesting. And typically healthcare takes a lot of time to catch up to tech. So I'm excited to see what changes are going to happen in healthcare. And then I asked her, okay, so but where is this all going? Like for people, AI is still hard to understand. The interface that makes it easy is like ChatGPT. If you haven't heard about it, it's a system that's created by OpenAI where you can basically prompt the AI by asking them questions. The AI gives you answers, but it's also a search engine. It's definitely affecting Google search because now people are searching the web in ChatGPT as opposed to going to Google search. Actually, the answers are more accurate in ChatGPT than Google because Google gives you links to websites, whereas ChatGPT gives you the answers. So it's pretty cool. I'm curious, if you find this interesting, give me a comment or a thumbs up because I can geek out about all of this. And, you know, I actually have a playlist on learning with ChatGPT, so make sure to check it out. And if you have any questions, just leave them in the comments. So then we were talking about the next opportunity, which is in UX UI design. So chatbots behind it and learning conversationally. So what that means is that whoever creates the most friendly UX UI design will kind of be ahead of the curve. So far, it's ChatGPT that has done it, which makes it super easy for us to use the technology. And if it becomes very easy to converse with AI, then we're kind of going to be ahead of the curve here. And so far, ChatGPT is kind of the winner in this UX UI design friendly interface, as well as the accessibility of asking questions and getting the answers. I asked her what's going to happen in the next 2 years, 10 years. So she did mention that we're going to have a lot of time for ourselves. So that's going to impact the tourist and travel industries and hospitality in general, hotels, because more people are going to outsource their job to AI and be able to travel. Maybe even more remote work opportunities will be available. And she did say that we will reach artificial superior intelligence, which is singularity. And that's going to happen in 2 years. I've read some reports in the next decade. But she pretty much believes it will be in the next 2 years, which means that the AI will be smarter than the human. I'm wondering, what is that going to do actually to our brain? Because think about it. It makes it very easy for AI to give us the answer. My biggest worry about AI is, are we going to be inspired to think critically, or are we becoming lazy and have AI just give us the answer? I think it's going to also change the structure of our brain. That's singularity in 2 years. Pretty cool. And she's excited about that because we'll be able to solve, for example, protein folding problem, or the deep mind acquired by Google is going to help us unlock millions years of evolution. So we will definitely have breakthroughs in medical and health and sciences because of AI. And I'm kind of going to be curious, how will that impact our understanding of evolution or aging or the human species? So that's kind of interesting. And then there's the other side of AI, is that can we build companies just using AI? I'm sure you've heard the one person $1 billion company. There's a race in Silicon Valley to basically build a company that is $1 billion evaluation, and it's run by maybe one person and AI. How she framed is, AI is a fast moving freight train. It will save us money and productivity. It will save us time. The biggest job opportunity, as I mentioned before, is the AI agents. They're software engineers or people in general that can manage the AI. She also talked about a book that we should read called Genesis, where people will have more time, go into early retirement, go on vacation. Actually, what will happen is that people in corporations will actually want to retire earlier. And so those are the opportunities. And for young people, AI creates a new structure of living and a new lifestyle. Rather than just purely operating in a consumer society, we are actually looking at other modalities of living where we structure our day based on lifelong learning, meaning what can we learn, what can we create, rather than what can we consume. So it's going to shift our consciousness into a lifestyle of learning and creativity. That's what I wanted to mention. And I asked her some of the challenges of mental health. Definitely mental health will continue to be a issue. We're a species that likes to be outside a lot. And if AI makes our life more convenient and the answers are just more accessible, how much effort are we actually going to put into thinking critically and thinking kinesthetically? So that's going to be a challenge. AI will do a lot of mundane tasks for us. But what's going to happen is that with more online educational opportunities, for example, this is great for content creators because we can use AI to help us do research faster, to structure scripts, to structure videos like these. We can tailor content for your specific needs. So more people will look online, and right now YouTube is the largest streaming platform, and they'll look for ways to learn new skills like sailing, she mentioned. So that's going to be interesting. The last thing I asked her, what about the connection to loneliness, and has AI minimized the gap of loneliness or increased it? And she said definitely that will continue to be a problem. Something that she's done with SameGrain, which is the company I mentioned earlier, is she utilized social with tech, and she found a way to reduce the veteran suicide rate using this technology. So AI and technology in general is an opportunity for solving social issues, which is pretty exciting to me because I really think about social impact, and I enjoy utilizing technology that for the greater good, that creates a social impact, that makes our life more easy, that makes us more resourceful, because these are just tools. ChatGPT shouldn't replace the way we think, but it should actually create tools on and maybe structure our lifestyle a little bit differently, which is exciting to me. And she's actually also a writer. She's working on a science fiction novel and we're talking about it, but I won't spoil that for you. If you found this video helpful and if it's giving you some ideas about how to think about AI in a more constructive way without having such an emotional connection or disconnection, because either, like, you know how it is in the news, we either hate it or love it. AI is like when the internet came out. It's a huge wave that's coming. At first it's scary, but we're going to learn how to use it because it's going to become as accessible. I remember when I started using ChatGPT in November 2020 when it first came out, I was one of the first 50,000 users to use it because my ex-boyfriend was a software engineer. So we were able to access the technology because he was a developer. And now it's, I think we're almost at 500,000 or 1 million people that use ChatGPT. I have to check that, but it's definitely interesting. In the next video, we're going to talk about a couple of future of work trends. I'm sure you have heard in the news that AI influencers are becoming increasingly common and profitable. So I'm going to talk about some of the future trends that I see that I've been reading when it comes to AI. And as always, do the best that you can every day.